We're going to have Dr. Brian Sheedy come to us now. Dr. Sheedy is the medical director of palliative care program at Tallahassee Memorial Hospital, and he will be talking to you about the medical aspects of dying and palliative care.
I know his practice of visit Father Tom is just the article in the paper last Saturday did have me as a medical director for a Big Ben hospice physician, and I must say I'm not that. Never have been. My own family, my father-in-law, my mother, my father, my youngest sister have been recipients of Big Ben hospice services in their lifetime and at the end of their lives. And every day I talk to the hospice liaisons for Big Ben and Covenant Hospice at the hospital. So this is just a little, it's where I am right now. I retired from medical practice of a private practice hematologist oncologist 8 years ago. Left a practice from six of us. And after a very brief retirement, became a palliative care consultant at Tallahassee Memorial Hospital, which I've been doing for the last over 7.5 years. Just to give you a brief idea of what palliative care means in the hospital. This is our team. We are a physician, two nurse practitioners, an administrative coordinator, social worker, dedicated social worker, and we work with the hospital chaplains. We have one chaplain assigned to our service, but we use the other chaplains as well. So it's kind of we try to be a multidisciplinary, comprehensive team. We started off with just a chaplain, a nurse practitioner, and myself in October of 2009. We've gotten busier, we've gotten bigger, but this is probably getting close to my time to turn over to somebody else. Our mission is basically palliative care is not always end-of-life care. We are not just there, although a lot of the reason I'm explaining this is a lot of people understand that we kind of get called in at the end, and we do that sometimes. But a lot of what we do is the idea of addressing the burden imposed by any illness or disease. Cases from trauma, so we try to address the symptom burden, pain, shortness of breath, immobility, depression, anxiety. So our idea is to come along and help the medical staff, the physician, the nurses, the technicians caring for the patients, to fine-tune the symptom management. And many of our staff do that very well already, so we sometimes come to see a patient where we don't have to do much of that. It's already being done well. The other thing would be, this is kind of from our little information we can pass out. Basically, if you do this really, I'm not gonna do it. Are we hospice? No, I'm not hospice, but I would say that all hospice services are palliative care. In other words, a person is involved and enrolled in hospice either as an inpatient or at home. Obviously, the goal of hospice is to support the patients, manage their symptoms, support the family and the other caregivers in caring for this person when we recognize they probably are suffering from the end of their life. And usually by law in our country, hospital services as posed by Medicare and insurances relate to two physicians certifying that a person has a prognosis deemed to be 6 months or less, and that person has asked to be supported symptomatically, spiritually, physically, have their family supported, their caregivers supported to the end of life. We often get asked to see patients before that phase. We're not always involved at the end of life. We do not perform euthanasia. As Father Tom said, euthanasia is the intentional taking of someone's life. so-called mercy clinics. And this is allowed by law in certain European countries. We have people here who advocate for this service. There are people in Netherlands and Belgium who are, by law, are, take lives because they deem that this person is somehow demented, somehow deteriorated to the point where it's more compassionate to just give them a fatal injection of something that will end their life very quickly. We do not have it. It's not allowed in this country, but there are people who move for this in the U.S. and Canada. Some of our states have a more liberal attitude toward physician-assisted suicide. So a physician who tries to prevent illness, to diagnose illness, to treat illness, to cure illness, we know that we fail ultimately. We will all die from something, but there are people who think that part of our task as physicians is to give you the means to quickly take your life. You know, that's something that I feel is wrong ethically, morally, but it's legal in some parts of this country. Oregon, Washington, Montana, it's becoming legal in California. There's an organization in the state of New York to allow physician-assisted suicide.
Dr. Sheedy, you're passing some of your slides.
Yeah, my goodness.
You missed three back.
Okay. I'm not very good at this technology.
You missed two before that.
Did I really? Okay.
There you go.
Okay, this we're just talking about the. This is a model. I have to say my medical education consisted of learning to diagnose disease, learning to treat disease, learning the reasons for people have disease and making treatment plans. And some of what I learned was, just pick up. Thank you, Father. Thanks. But we now know that part of our thought process in medicine and nursing should be to, from the beginning of a diagnosis, to think about, yes, do you want to treat, do you want to modify the disease, do you want to cure the disease? It's not always possible. So some things some diseases we require, some disorders we require are treatable but not curable. So as part of that, you'd like to say, my treatment may impose a burden. For example, as an oncologist, giving chemotherapy to prevent recurrence of disease is, you know, the good part of it is this person has risk for recurrence of their breast cancer, their colon cancer. We may give people strong drugs now to lessen the chance of recurrence. These drugs designed to prevent recurrence or potentially prolong life may bring suffering, nausea, pain, depression, anxiety. It may change a person's functions in the family. So for physicians and nurses that are doing this work, you have to think in terms of trying to treat the disease, but at the same time, as the disease may progress and time goes by, there may be flare-ups where the patient's symptoms are great. So we try to address that. But this is just kind of a model saying, this is time going this way. We're trying to modify rheumatoid arthritis, lupus, kidney failure, cancer, chronic obstructive lung disease, heart disease. And part of it is when we realize we've gotten to the point where we cannot cure the illness, we try to help the patient make the transition. Speaking as an old oncologist, the patients you work with longest, you develop a patient-physician bond, for better or for worse. Then there are points where you have to change the goal of your care, the limits of your care. And it's an uncomfortable transaction for some people. The patient does not want to let you down, and the physician does not want the patient down. So those are uncomfortable conversations that have to be made sometimes. And sometimes your partner, sometimes your nurse, or sometimes a relative of the patient say, hey doc, my spouse is dying, please, let's stop the aggressive active treatment, let's focus on other things. Symptoms, setting more reasonable goals, study more reasonable planning. So that's a difficult transaction sometimes. So this is just kind of a model saying, at the end of life, we should wholeheartedly go into hospice, if it's predictable. And then after death, the other wedge indicates the bereavement process, where you need people like hospice, family, church. And hopefully your physician and nurses and caregivers will also help people heal from that loss. Oops. This is how I got involved, just briefly, medical school, residency, military, fellowship, and practicing. But the bottom line is life experience. I am better now as an old man with hearing aids and glasses. But when I was a 30-something fresh pup, I thought I knew a lot then, but life makes you humble and realize that you don't know anything. And honestly, I have made plenty of mistakes. I have let down my patients at times by misdirection, by not picking up on clues, by being overly aggressive. You think sometimes you know a lot, and the experience comes up to smack you in the face and teach you you don't know everything. So this has been a gradual process. I'm still learning, but I think I'm better than I was 5 years ago, 10 years ago, and certainly better than I was 35 years ago. No question about that. At the same time, I'm a human being. I make mistakes. I miss clues. I miss speak. I'm not afraid to apologize every week to somebody I let down. This is the process in the hospital. In the hospital, it consists of being asked by a physician to see their patient, reviewing the records fairly quickly, interviewing the patient, examining the patient. Sometimes we can't interview the patients. The patients are comatose, or demented, or badly injured, so we have to speak to their surrogate, their wife, their husband, their child, their partner, to find out what these patients' goals and values are. So our idea is to try to figure out who's in charge. And some of our patients are so ill, it's not apparent. We have patients who have not ever had a conversation with anybody, or their families are in such disarray that there's never been communication about their wishes or their goals. So under Florida law, there's a hierarchy of who can speak for someone else. We have some people who are homeless, so we actually have social workers who can stand in as a guardian for a patient who has no one to speak for them. Usually the spouse speaks for them. If the spouse is alive or has capacity for making decisions. But then it begins with the oldest child over 18, things of that sort. And we can, as you can imagine, our life is complicated with blended families, non-existent families, dysfunctional families. We sometimes have a hard time finding who's in charge to help make decisions for the goals and plans of care. This is basically what we're trying to do. Are we doing a good job of managing pain, anxiety, shortness of breath? And our role is educational, and we also try to help with order sets for patients who need some symptom management. And then, of course, follow up. Don't just appear once, get a snapshot, make a plan, and walk away. We try to see how the process works and how things go along. Obviously, these are the things we confront. Pain management, air hunger. If you had any relatives with heart failure, lung failure, Father Tom alluded to the difficulty of artificial hydration and nutrition. And I must say, experience has taught me that this may be a very gray area. What we consider ordinary medicine here may not be available in parts of the country and major parts of the world. So sometimes we Americans and Europeans who have a certain standard of living have available to us medical nursing services at very high levels. And the question of what's extraordinary versus ordinary comes into play in our discussion every week. Clearly, problems we deal with, we've all walked here today with various levels of functionality, but some of us struggle with walkers and canes and wheelchairs. We notice those are markers of vulnerabilities, but every one of us is vulnerable, even those who are walking on their own 2 feet without assistance. I recognize now that I wear glasses since I was 40. I've had hearing aids for 5 or 6 years, and I probably should have gotten them earlier. I no longer can do gymnastics. I don't climb up trees anymore, or rooftops. I don't walk on top of fences anymore. So my body is changing, and we have to deal with some of these things. We have some people whose neighbors are in denial. They're so close to the person's physical decline that they don't recognize it. And the shock is they come into the hospital and they just think, just a quick tune-up, some fluids and some drugs, and grandma will be back home with us, function right before. Many of these things that we spot are markers of our decline, and sometimes they're markers of an accelerated decline. Some of us have been through this before. Other thing we often confront is loving caregivers who are really don't recognize how burned out they are from caregiving for a demented spouse or a profoundly disabled spouse or a child. Our concerns are helping the patient, if the patient can speak with us, develop what do you want? Many people have done some sort of planning before. They have gone through this discussion before because they've witnessed firsthand in some loved one or friend and they struggle with making a good plan. So much of what we do besides main symptoms is finding out what people want. And part of the problem is some people don't understand what we can do, what doctors and nurses can do. So they expect too much. They expect you walk into the emergency room, you get shocked, and a couple days later you're saying goodbye to the nurses, everything's fine. That's not always the reality. We have people who, I just mentioned something from last week. We had a man that, younger than I am, man, but who is not particularly compliant with taking care of his health, who was hospitalized for a problem based on his non-compliance while in the hospital and suffered cardiac arrest, and in spite of being promptly resuscitated as far as his electrical activity in his heart, his brain suffered severe damage from a lack of blood flow that occurred just over a period of minutes. One of his younger relatives, one of the informed by the neurologists, the neurosurgeons, the critical care doctors, this man's brain is badly damaged. He is not recovered and it's not even accept. He's not going to get better. And a relative offered to donate their brain to do a brain transplant. Well, you don't smirk or laugh at someone like that because they're looking out of caring and compassion, but they've heard about heart transplants for 50 years now, kidney transplants for about 50 years now. They hear about bone marrow transplants, they hear about lung transplants, so why not a brain transplant? So it's always something you have to say to yourself, don't smile, don't laugh, just look them aside and say, that's not possible today. And not promising that tomorrow will be promising either. So we also have to deal with the uncertainties of how to predict what will happen. One thing that medicine and nursing teaches people is that we like to prognosticate. People like to know. If you watch movies, you watch TV programs where somebody has to say a person has got 3 months or 6 months or a week to live. That is not certain. But there are certain experiences and there's certain data that tells you approximately how long certain people with certain stages of disease will live. But obviously this is statistical data. It does not apply to individuals. And we often are troubled by the fact that people say, my father has cirrhosis. He's not a candidate for a liver transplant. How long will he live? And there's data about how long people with certain organ system failures will live. Some of the patients we see have more than one organ system failure. So it's difficult sometimes. And we have people who, physicians who disagree among themselves about prognostication. So these are difficulties we encounter. But there are data for many diseases, but I could say that you all, all we all have to admit that we don't know sometimes. These are people, everybody here is interested to be here today, but there are plenty of people in this world who have, they know where the food and water goes and where it comes out, they know how to make babies, they know how to put their clothes on, but they have no idea what happens in between that sometimes. And there are people who are woefully ignorant of human biology and function. Not that we all have to be doctors and nurses, but most of us have had some basic biology, and we've also encountered our families certain things, and we can learn certain things. But we come across folks who are the decision makers for patients who are woefully ignorant of the realities of life, live in denial, or just in ignorance. And so you have to, with compassion and understanding, confront these people and try to bring up the speed, but it doesn't work all the time. Okay. So what do? We have to quickly decide what is going on. We also have to quickly get an idea about what interventions are available and how good are they, and what are the burdens versus the benefits of these things. We try to communicate quickly what's available to families and patients, because we'll see a critically ill patient in an ICU where the cardiologist who's treated the person for their heart attack last year notes their heart muscle was functioning at 10% efficiency. And 6 months after the heart attack, it's 15% efficiency. So what is the patient here? I'm 50% better than I was last year. Not that I've had a severe heart attack, I'm really functioning at that. The patient's nephrologist, the kidney specialist, walks in and says, your kidney function is poor, but it's better than it was a week ago when you came in the hospital, by a little bit. People think, that's wonderful. Our job is to kind of put the whole thing together and say, this combination is deadly. Yes, you're functioning, but you're functioning very poorly. There are limited options of what we can do. So sometimes we try to synthesize the input from various specialists to try and make a reality-based picture, knowing that I'm not an expert in certain things, but I've learned from my colleagues what it takes and how one disease process impacts another. Because this is one patient who may have 3 or 4 times. Here in the hospital consists of, and there are times when we'll get a call from a clinician, a nurse or a doctor saying, can you come quick? I know you're busy today, but can you come quick? We have a patient in the ICU who's not doing well, and the family's decided to stop everything. That's a common thing. Well, we don't stop everything. You know, the issue of people, this may turn pull the plug. It's a non-medical term, but we have people come up to me and they say, are you here to pull the plug? I say, no, I'm here to find out what this patient would want, and no matter what we can do to help them be comfortable, to assist you, so you don't quit. And even healthcare workers, physicians and nurses will sometimes say, I can't do any more for you or your loved one. We need to stop treating. Those are powerful words, but they're words that I try never to use, and I've learned not to use things like that. I say, what we need to do is we need to redirect, we need to change our goals, we need to change our plan of care to reflect what this patient would want, given the fact that they're probably going to die soon. We want to make sure that that process is acceptable to them. You want to manage their pain if that's what they want. You want to manage their air hunger if that's what they want. We want to help their anxiety and depression if that's what they want. And sometimes people misunderstand that we're just going to walk in and things are going to be taken care of. That's not what we want. We want to make sure that the eyes are cared for, mouth, skin is cared for, pain is addressed. That if people are nearing the end of their life, they're accompanied in a way as much as they want to be accompanied. And if they're in spiritual distress, we want to use the chaplains. We want to use our clergy to assist. So these are other issues that we come across all the time. We also find patients who clearly are close to death, and they have chosen that the family members have said, "This we recognize that we really are not benefiting from the hospital stay. The patient's too sick to go home sometimes, so they will become an inpatient for hospice, and then the hospice will take over to help the staff care for the patient during, which typically is short life. Some of the patients are transferred to hospice house. My name is sister, the date of her life is, her husband and that mother died in her house, and she went to hospice house for the last week of her life. I'm just kind of babbling right now a little bit, but difficulties. Unrealistic expectations of what medicine and nursing can do. Cultural issues. We have this sort of thing. We are ethnically diverse here, but mostly European Americans. But I've learned that there are different ways of dealing with illness. There are different levels of communication that takes place in certain families and certain cultures. So we try to be culturally sensitive and listen to what people have. So one of our commonest questions to him is, what do you understand that you've been told by the doctors and nurses about what's going on? And hear what they perceive. And sometimes what they perceive is way different from what we think is on the record. So that's a common starting point. Find out what do they understand about what's going on? How do they perceive the person's feeling? And what can medicine and nursing do? Some folks are getting quickly, other folks are fighting us. We have dysfunctional families where, an example, a 90-year-old demented lady was cared for lovingly by her youngest daughter for years. And the family is dispersed all over the country. The patient is in decline. And you go in and ask the daughter, who is a surrogate for your demented mother? All of us are. There's no clear-cut line of authority. And there's different degrees of attachment of the relatives to the situation. There's different degrees of understanding, there's different age groups in a large family. And this leads to sometimes some bad decision making. And it's a problem we have to confront. And sometimes we can't solve it. It just goes on and on and on because you're trying to get people to make an appropriate, compassionate plan of care. And there's an outlier who just doesn't believe this person's gonna die or is suffering, and they fight everybody. So, and then we have patients who pick somebody and tell them what they want if they can't speak anymore, and then that person is undermined by other relatives who threaten, or in some case, if you let my daddy die, I'll never forget this, and they threaten, and it does come back to some people. So we have to confront some of that dysfunction. And obviously, the personalities. Sometimes you walk into a room and you start to talk to somebody and you just don't hit it off. That's when your nurse practitioner rescues you sometimes. or you do the good cop, bad cop thing. So that happens sometimes. This is just for everybody here. We do need to communicate our personal goals and values related to medical care. And it's nice when you have documentation of this, when you can tell people, write it down. The other biggest problem with documents is people don't share them widely sometimes. I did oncology. People would bring me a copy of their advanced directive, so I'm here, Doc, I did this, I went to a meeting at my church, you fill this thing out, here's your copy. And so my first question is, did you read it? or I saw my lawyer and I had some, I got a will updated, I had a durable power training to pay the bills if I get demented or have a stroke. And I had this advanced directive, and then the other person says, did you read it? And so those are things that we, many of us have those kind of things. We put them in a strong box or at the bank, and we forget about them, and we don't share with our own relatives or our own doctors and caregivers. So it's nice to be able to spread those things around. Make copies when you get to a certain age, give them to your kids. This is a copy, it's not the legal copy, but you've got a copy of it. So here's some guidelines. And I always tell people, if you make a plan, you always change your mind. As long as you have capacity for decision making, you may change your mind. Now, just obviously, people here who have consulted lawyers to write wills are always asked, okay. And the hospital will give you a document if you walk in the door. They offer you, choose a surrogate if you lose your capacity to speak. There's an ad hoc form in the hospital. Catholic Health Directive, you can get it off the Florida Catholic Conference website and download and read it, sign it. I don't see Paul Malley here, talking about the Five Wishes document. It's a great conversation starter, but it can become a document that you can use in many states as a legal document. And I tell some people who have got terrible illnesses, the state of Florida has a do not resuscitate form. It's a big yellow sheet. If you ever want the capacity to tell your home caregivers, don't call the paramedics. Sometimes a well-meaning home health care nurse will call paramedics to resuscitate a dying patient. And they're in the hospital, this process starts till a doctor shows up. So I would say some people consider that if you're caring for a loved one who's got a fatal illness, usually the hospice nurses that help you do this, but some people say, we're going to do our own hospice. We don't have hospice. But then you have a patient die at home, some well-meaning relative or neighbor calls paramedics. The paramedics are obligated to do CPR to intubate the patient and bring him to the hospital. That may save some grief, so that's why I stuck that up there. I hope my thoughts have not been too disorganized. Father Tom touched on the idea of some of the ethical areas, and there are some areas where it's a gray area in our discussion in the hospital today, where we have to talk about how far to go with artificial hydration and nutrition. The boundary between extraordinary care and ordinary care is sometimes very gray and hard to define and arguable. And I can say that it's something we confront every week with many patients. That's all for now. I'll stay around and ask you some questions. Consultation service, so it's not like the hospital has order sets for physicians to make sure that there's orders are not missed, and there's a comfort measure order set that some people choose. I want my loved one to be comforted, so we manage the pain, we manage dry eyes, we manage a dry mouth, we keep the skin care. So there are comforts, but palliative care is not it's a service, but it doesn't define a particular program. We want to make sure that we assess the symptomatic needs and supportive needs, and that the goal of the patient is recognized and valued and respected. If not the patient cannot speak for themselves, what do they want? So the outcomes for us in the hospital are very different. You may say, I don't want to be intubated. I don't want to be resuscitated, but I want my antibiotics, my IV, I want my surgery. And that's what patients with child say, I want everything done, but if I die, goodness, let me go. I don't want to undergo this. And we have people who believe that resuscitation is easy in a 90-year-old. It's not. you know, our bones are fragile and soft. We kind of push blood from the heart to vital organs, particularly the brain, and a person is already demented. What are we doing sometimes? We do it sometimes because the family demands us to do those sort of things. So we do not have an inpatient ward. We see patients all over the place. In some places, they have more mature, older, well-supported palliative care programs. They have a few beds for inpatient palliative care. I took some training in Richmond at Virginia Commonwealth University. The university hospital did not have good relations to hospice, so they had an inpatient palliative care unit, which is kind of like a hospital, like hospice house in the hospital. Right now, at some point, I would say in a few years, we'll have an outpatient clinic, perhaps at the cancer center at TMH. Perhaps that will happen. But right now, we are not hospice, but we work closely with them, and some of our care does involve end of life care. So the question is many patients have complex illnesses that impact many systems. The big thing is we have specialists that are expert in many different disease areas. And our job is really to try to look at all those things and pull them together. When we're not experts, we try to synthesize, this is one human being who has cirrhosis, who's got kidney failure, who's got emphysema, heart failure, and is getting demented, or has prostate cancer. Sometimes each individual has got something to say about their process, what they're interested in, and many people are able to put it together, but sometimes the patients and their families have not put it together, and they're confused by things that someone walks in and quickly says something, and they've got 20 patients to see, they leave. And then the next person says something a little bit different or using different words, and misunderstandings develop. So one of our commonest approaches to people is to say, what have you been told about your illness or your loved one's illness? What do you understand about it? And what do you understand about what the plans are, what options have been offered to you? And then what do you understand about what is the benefit, the anticipated benefit versus the burden of that, those options. And that's where we end up spending, trying to quickly get a snapshot of where the patient is, and then we try to quickly make a reasonable plan and then see what the patient and the family respond to that. And our job is we sometimes have to tell our colleagues, the way you present this is overly optimistic, it appears to me, given the circumstances. And occasionally we'll come across people who are families that want things who are overly pessimistic too. You know, this really occurs, but occasionally we get a family where they just want to get things over with for somebody, and they're in a hurry for someone to die. Honestly, it doesn't happen very often, but occasionally it does happen. So we have to say, whoa, let's see what we can do, and let's let nature take its course. Let's see what we can do to help this person. Let's not rush. Rush to death sometimes.
Sure.
Bob?
You know, Dr. Sheedy, Bobby Bowden used to say when he had a special football player, that player has it. And I think, you know, you reflected on your career, and I think as a doctor, you have it.
Thank you, Bob. I'll see you later. No. Every week I make mistakes. I underestimate, I overestimate. I think I understand the situation. So this one thing life teaches you is humility. You learn from your mistakes, you should learn from your mistakes, I should say. And I make fewer mistakes than I used to, I think, I hope. But sometimes you still make mistakes, and you sometimes don't proceed with, or your own physical resources and those are gone. I can tell you, at 5 o'clock in the afternoon, I have to sit down and document these computers, and I can hardly see them at 5 o'clock in the afternoon, you know? I mean, I stare at the hospital computers and I'm just, I want to go home. And then someone says, can you come and talk to this family that was going to be here at 3 o'clock, now they're here at 6 o'clock? And you go, oh, please, spare me.